Alright, so in this session I would like to talk about the inner workings of SMT solvers. As you've seen, SMT solvers have many useful applications, such as automated reasoning and program verification. You can think of an SMT solver like a black box that takes in a bunch of constraints in the form of first-order logic and returns a satisfying assignment. What does the satisfying assignment mean then? The simplest example is a Boolean satisfiability algorithm, which takes in a formula in Boolean logic and returns a value for each variable that will make the formula true. And we can find that, for example, with a very simple brute force search. So we would guess a value for each variable. At some point, we might hit a dead end, so we backtrack and search a different part of the tree until we find an assignment that actually makes the formula true. Real-world algorithms would use more advanced techniques, for example, unit propagation, which is when you have one variable and a bunch of other stuff. You can just deduce that it's true instead of guessing it, so you just know the value automatically. Another example is clause learning, so every time you reach a dead end, you sort of learn from your mistakes and remember what you've just learned for future parts of the tree. There are also many more techniques that I won't go into. Now, I would like to point out that if we're able to prove satisfiability, we can also actually make proofs. So say we have some formula phi that we want to prove, we can try to satisfy its negation. So it's like proof by contradiction. And if we can find a counterexample, it means that the original formula is false, otherwise it means that it's true. But in real-world applications, we want to reason about more than just Booleans. We want to reason about numbers or floats or lists and stuff like that. A naive approach would be to use bit vectors. So the computer encodes everything in binary, right? Why not just express that binary as a Boolean formula? But that, of course, is going to be very slow because, say, we have two integers, that's already 64 bits, and 64 variables will be a ton of work. So we want to have some way to reason about specific domains of problems. We're going to do that using the concept of a theory solver, and I will explain an approach which is usually referred to as the very lazy approach. A theory solver is any decision procedure that can take a conjunction of formulas A and B and C and spit out whether they're satisfiable or not. An example for that would be Gauss-Jordan elimination for a system of linear equations. And the theory solver can operate only on formulas specific to its theory. Now, sometimes we want to work with more complicated expressions, but that's not a problem because we can just use the DPLL here to give us some satisfying assignment, and then this assignment is just a conjunction. So there's this sort of back and forth between DPLL and the theory solver. The DPLL will keep giving us assignments until we find one that the theory solver agrees on. Now, what if we have a formula with more than one theory? This formula, for example, has functions, it has arithmetic, it has lists, and also, of course, Boolean logic. What we're going to do is a purely syntactic substitution, where we just introduce new variables to separate out different theories. So now, as you can see, for example, this one is just arithmetic, this one is just functions, this one is just lists, and this one is just arithmetic again. And we can send each of these to its own theory solver. But that doesn't quite work. So this is what we're doing right now. And imagine, for example, a system of equations again. What this is doing is basically saying, oh, the first equation is solvable, the second equation is solvable, and so on. But that doesn't mean that all the equations are solvable simultaneously, right? Because different solvers might have shared variables, and we want to make sure that they all agree on them. So for that, we have Nelson-Oppen. We take all the shared variables, and we decide on some sort of configuration for them. And that's built from interface equalities, so equalities between shared variables. We start by guessing a configuration. So we guess for each one of these whether it's an equality or an inequality. And we can keep guessing more and more configurations until we find a configuration that works. Now that we have a configuration, we're going to test that together at the same time with the formula that we're trying to prove. And Nelson-Oppen says that if we can find any configuration where all the theory solvers agree about, it means that our original formula is also true. And there are also ways to improve that, but I'm running out of time, so I'm going to skip on that. So this is the very basics of SMT solvers. If you're interested in the more in-depth details, feel free to come to my Discord channel where I have gathered a list of resources about SMT. And also you can visit my GitHub where I'm working on a very simple SMT solver for my language.